May Jesus reveal the mysteries. Help us to understand the message that you will share today. In Jesus' name. Amen. The Apostle Paul, in explaining the circumstances of the communion service to the new believers in the city of Corinth, highlighted an interesting point to them. And I take you to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 and 24. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 and 24. The Apostle Paul says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Here Paul provided significant details and he shed light on three major actions that occurred in a sequence and which involve our Savior Jesus Christ. The record clearly alerted us and alerts us that one, Jesus on that one occasion delicately took some bread and blessed it. Number two, Jesus was just as delicate with the wine as he was with the bread in giving a divine blessing on the wine. And number three, it was on that same night that he was betrayed, that night when he allowed himself to be double-crossed, that night when he allowed himself to experience disappointment, that night. Now the traitor on that night disclosed the closely guarded secret about Jesus that night. You see, the secret wasn't about which of the 13 is Jesus, but it was about the religious leaders locating him that night so that they could put him to death. But as I study this text, I have to ask the question, what was about to happen, or what had happened that moved Jesus to distribute bread and wine that same night? A critical question. What was about to happen, or what had occurred that motivated Jesus to distribute bread and wine that night? We will have to take a peek into the background, and I want to take you then to St. Matthew chapter 26, please. St. Matthew chapter 26, go with me to St. Matthew chapter 26, verse 20 to 25, as we look at the background to the text in Rome in 1 Corinthians. So, the writer, Matthew chapter 26, verse 20 says, "When evening had come, he sat down with the 12. Now as they were eating, he said, 'Assuredly, I say to you, one of you will betray me.' And they were exceedingly sorrowful, and each of them began to say, 'Lord, is it I?' He answered and said, 'He who dipped his hands with me in the dish will betray me. The Son of Man indeed goes just as it is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been good for that man if he had not been born.'" Then Judas, who was betraying him, answered and said, "Rabbi, is it I?" The writer informs us that Jesus did not beat around the bush, but he laid his cards plainly on the table. And as Jesus uncovered the plot to betray him in verse 25, his heart must have been filled with sadness. Sorrow must have been printed on the innocent faces except one. Judas, the traitor, sat with Jesus, eating and fellowshipping as if everything was okay. I must pause here and alert you that had the communion table been reserved only for the righteous and the holy, Judas should never have taken communion. And therefore, the communion table is not reserved for the righteous and the holy. It's reserved for the sinners. Because it's at the communion table that your sins are washed and cleansed and you're revived and you're rejuvenated. Yes, it's true that 1 Corinthians talks about we preparing ourselves before we come so that we don't eat unworthily. But as we go on this year, we will look at this concept of who is worthy. Because none of us sitting here today is worthy. So we go back to the text. Looking into Judas' face with a grin, with a smile, while Satan had already filled Judas' heart to carry out the most heinous crime, that of being a traitor to God in the flesh. Could any of his disciples betray and sell out the great teacher? The one who shared his wonderful love with them? You see, Satan had entered Judas' heart, planted the idea in his mind, and it began to germinate, quickly blossom, to produce the deadly poison, as we saw, as we will see in Luke chapter 22, verse 3. Luke tells us, chapter 22, verse 3. Let's go to verse 1. Now the feast of the unleavened bread drew near, which is called the Passover, and the chief priests and the scribes saw how they might kill him, for they feared the people. Chapter verse 3. Then Satan entered Judas, surnamed Iscariot, who was numbered among the 12. So he went his way and conferred with the chief priests and captains how he might betray him to them. John also tells us in John chapter 13, verse 2, this what actually happened also. John chapter 13, verse 2 tells us as we read. And supper being ended, the devil having already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had not come from God and was going to, that he had come from God and was going to God, rose from supper, laid aside his garments, took a towel, and girded himself. Satan entered Judas' heart. The deal was done, sealed. If we pause though, Judas could have repented. But you see, Jesus gave Judas the opportunity at the table to repent. And that's why we have the foot washing. That's the opportune moment that we can still make things right with each other. It's at the foot washing. Betrayal, deception, surrounding the group. Sin was evident. It's not what was done, but how was Jesus betrayed? The writer of the first gospel informed us earlier that the deal had already been sealed. Back to John chapter 26. Verse 14 to 16. Then one of the 12, called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priest and said, "What are you willing to give me if I deliver him to you?" So here's the deal. I'm willing to give Jesus up. I'm willing to surrender him to you. I'm willing to trade Jesus. But what will you give me? And they counted out to him 30 pieces of silver. What are we selling out Jesus for? So from that time, he saw opportunity to betray Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. But as Jesus broke the bread, he was indicating to us the experience he would endure. The sin that had been secretly planned needed forgiveness, and the person needed cleansing. The act of cleansing could only be accomplished through the blood of Jesus. Jesus shared the symbols through which they can receive forgiveness and cleansing because he knew they were burdened. That's why Jesus shared the bread and wine, the blessed bread and wine. Because without that, the sin would have remained. And that's why Judas could have repented. As he shared the bread and wine, he was extending forgiveness to his sinful disciples. Indeed, Jesus was broken so that we may experience healing because we are also broken. We are broken by life's challenges. We are broken by unfaithful friends. We are broken by disappointments. We are broken by harsh words. We are broken by bad choices and bad decisions. But Jesus was broken that we may experience healing. Wounds have been inflicted on us, and we seek healing from pain. We seek healing from our troubled hearts, and we seek healing from our troubled minds that have been bombarded with all kinds of elements. We seek healing. We can get healing at the cross. And Jesus also provided that healing for us when he set up the communion table. As Jesus shared the bread and wine, he was offering a balm, or the balm, in Gilead. That makes the wounded whole. No wonder Jesus shared that remarkable insight in John chapter 6, verse 53 to 55. I keep alluding to it. John chapter 6, verse 53 to 55. Then Jesus said to them, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you." And here is the critical teaching. We cannot afford to miss the communion service. Every time we participate in the communion service, we are, as it were, we are ensuring that our eternal life continues or stays. Or in other words, we are looking forward. The communion service helps us to look forward then to the eternal life. Without the communion service, our eternal life will not be realized when Jesus comes. So this communion service, every time we participate, it inspires, it motivates, it alerts us of the need to keep faithful to Jesus, and being faithful to Jesus helps us to realize our eternal life when Christ comes. Participating in the bread and wine, symbols of Jesus' sacrifice, frees us from the guilt stains of sin. It rejuvenates our spiritual life and we remain connected. That's what Jesus says. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life. These are the words of Jesus. And therefore, the converse, the opposite is true. If you don't eat and drink of Jesus' blood and his flesh, you have no life. And my question or my concern could be is, could it be this is one of those major reasons why our folk backslide? It starts with the communion service. For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me. Every time we participate in the communion service, we are abiding in Jesus. And that's why we have to make the communion service so significant and so poignant and so pointed. It's not a flippant service. We need to understand that every time we come to the table, it moves us closer to Jesus. So we abide in him and he in us. When we look at the context surrounding this episode in Matthew chapter 26, we have to admit that it was the best time to provide healing for the betrayer, Judas. Jesus was engaging in what I call proactive healing. Judas had not yet done the deed, in other words, he had not yet gone out to the disciples, to the high priest and them, and showed where Jesus was, but he had already made a deal. But Jesus, before Judas actually betrayed him, Jesus engaged in proactive. In other words, Jesus forgave Judas before he did the deed. And Jesus could only have done that because he knew what he would have done, because Jesus and God are the same person. God is omnipotent, omnipresent, and omniscient. He is all-knowing, all-present, and all-powerful. So as we participate in this solemn service today, it helps us to see that we are all sinful and are in need of forgiveness. We are in need of a Savior. We are in need of the cleansing blood of Jesus. So when we eat the bread and drink the wine, it also helps us to recognize that we need to offer forgiveness and also need to be compassionate to each other. No wonder Luke records in Luke chapter 11, verse 4, and he says, "Forgive us our sins, as we forgive everyone who is indebted to us, and do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. It's not a choice. God forgives, we ought to forgive. As we forgive, God forgives. If we don't forgive, God is unable, not unwilling, He's unable to forgive, because we are unwilling to forgive. In our case, we extend a reactive forgiveness. We forgive when persons have done us wrong deeds, but Jesus engaged in proactive. He forgave before the deed was done. We either extend reactive forgiveness and move ahead in our spiritual walk with God, or we hold back the forgiveness and remain stagnant, static, and failing to grow spiritually. It seems to be a painful moment in that, right in the middle of desertion, right in the middle of betrayal, right in the middle of the arrest, right in the middle of trials and torture and denial, Jesus provided forgiveness. In the midst. It is from this that we see the forgiving nature of God, who is no respecter of persons. And we therefore must extend forgiveness to each other, because sin is like a prison. And we can only be set free when we extend forgiveness and when we are forgiven. Jesus expects us to be gracious, to be humble, and to be merciful. Never think that you will always be standing spiritually tall. One day you will need forgiveness, and therefore we ought to be willing to extend forgiveness. He that thinks he standeth, let him take heed lest he fall. Sin produces guilt which holds us down, keeps us in a tight grasp, and we are unable to escape. But the Holy Spirit speaking to us, we can be sure of having an opportunity to repent. We often feel the pain and long for a comforter. That's why Jesus went to Calvary, so that He can be our comforter, so that we can have the opportunity to come to Him and ask Him to forgive us of our sins. Just understand, there's nothing that can wash away our sins but the blood of Jesus. Amen. Lord, we thank you. Recognizing that we were born in sin and shaped in iniquity, recognizing, Lord, that we are sinful from birth, Father, we thank you for opening the way, opening the opportunity, giving us the chance to come to the throne of grace and ask for forgiveness of our sins. Lord, I pray even now that we will take full opportunity of this occasion, and as we come to the table of the prayer to participate in the emblems, O Lamb of God, I pray truly that each individual here who will participate, Lord, will be stirred, be motivated. Lord, their souls will rise up. And Lord, they will have that longing in their hearts to serve you and to be faithful, I ask in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.